Organizing for Life, written by Sandra Felton. This audio version is published by Oasis Audio through an agreement with Revell Books. Stay tuned to hear an exclusive interview with the author at the end of this audio. I'm Melinda Schmidt. Chapter 1. It's not about the house. It's not about the house. It really isn't. It's about the person who lives in the house. And that's you. You may go to your neighbor's houses, as I did, and find them sipping coffee at 10 in the morning, surrounded by tidy areas and shining surfaces. You, on the other hand, don't want to invite others to your place. If you are like I was, you may not even want to spend much time there yourself. Too much disorder, clutter, and mess. That translates into frustration, emotional drain, and just plain work for you, when you do it. I used to dream of moving into a new apartment, leaving all of my things, and maybe even my family, behind, and starting over clean. My longing was palpable. I yearned for order, beauty, harmony, peace, anything to get the burden of messiness off my back. Deep down, I knew it wasn't about the house. If my imaginary apartment had become real, it would have become just as cluttered, with or without my family, as the house I wanted to leave behind. It was about me. I was the one constant that made every place I lived the same. I was doing something mysterious that I was unaware of, that invariably muddled my environment wherever I went. What was it? As it turned out, there were several things that are addressed in this audiobook. Things that are at work in your life, as they were in mine, without your knowledge. The proof of their existence is evident as you look around you. For us all, no matter our location or circumstance, the house first starts to change in the heart and mind. Buy into the concept that the condition of your house reflects important things about you that need to be addressed. As I have already stated, it's not about the house. Nor is it about working harder or faster or even smarter. The smog of clutter around you will begin to lift as fresh thoughts and feelings sweep into your life. Working to alter the condition of the house will force you to examine and change what is going on there in relation to yourself. Its condition won't permanently change until you have addressed some of these important basics. Once you do, the house will be automatically transformed just as mysteriously as it became a mess because you have been transformed. Then, some morning, when you're sitting in your neat house sipping tea, your distressed neighbor may come to your door to escape the chaos she is fighting in her own house. And in the comfort you have created, you may say, "Come right on in. Have a seat, honey. Let me tell you what happened to me." Part 1. Understanding the Messy Mindset. The secret to change lies in the way we think about messiness and neatness. Somewhere in this section, you will find yourself and your way of thinking. Not all types will apply to you, but you will discover some destructive thought patterns that are so much a part of you that they seem normal. They are an important part of your housekeeping problems. Many women keep neat houses without being compulsive, and it's because they think differently from the way you do. You will find out their secret and learn to make it your own. Accepting yourself. Few people realize that the Goonie bird and the albatross are the same bird with different names. On land, it is the Goonie bird, ungainly and inept. In the air, it is the albatross, king of the sky. Messies are like this bird. In the area of organization, we are at our weakest, floundering in our attempts to be neat. Like the Goonie bird, we have no way to avoid functioning in our weak area. But like the albatross, we do have our sky. Messies function beautifully in many ways, soaring easily in our areas of strength. While we struggle to improve in the organizational area, We find satisfaction as we soar in other areas. Messies, however, usually don't see the beautiful side of themselves. All they see is the goony bird, and they don't like what they see. As a result, messies treat themselves badly. They're not very nice to themselves, not very nice at all. This is not evident at first, however. Messies are vibrant people who seem to participate in life to the hilt. Further examination, however, brings another underlying pattern to the surface. In hundreds of ways a day, messies, because of the way they think, treat themselves like second-class people. For messies, much of life goes on in the mind, so they don't like to be bothered with the day-to-day details of life. As a result, they put up with dripping plumbing and broken appliances because getting them fixed is too much trouble, or they need to clean up to let the plumber in. They live without enough light in important areas of the home because correcting the problem is more of a bother than living with it. On the other hand, messies always have good intentions. They keep old clothes, convinced that someday they will mend or update them. They have stashes of greeting cards they purchased but never got around to sending. Messies are forgetful, so they keep everything out where they can see it. If they put it away, they know they'll forget to do it. Messies are perfectionists, so they live in clutter and chaos because there's never enough time to do everything according to their high standards. Messies are impulsive and live in the moment, so when they decide to bake something special at the last minute, they rarely have the ingredients the recipe calls for. In light of this daily denial of what they need to make life comfortable, it is not surprising that they also deny themselves a place to sit on the sofa because it is covered with stuff. They deny themselves companionship because they can't invite guests over with the house the way it is. They sometimes sleep on the floor because the bed is piled with clothes they haven't had time to put away. But messies are used to self-denial. They do without or make do. Instead of recognizing the problem, they adjust to it, and they are very good at it. Many even take pride in their make-do approach. They are happy to show you how they do without the things other people, who recognize their worth and dignity, provide for themselves. Ultimately, messies deny themselves a life of serenity and beauty. They insult themselves with disorganization on such a regular basis that they are unaware of it. The messy house is just part of the picture of a person who consistently abuses herself. Messiness is just the top of a very deep pile of problems. At its heart, messiness is a problem of self-neglect. The first step. To put an end to this pattern of denial, messies must first stop fighting themselves. If we get angry at ourselves and go to war against certain character traits every time we see them, we only give them the energy to stay. The more we struggle against the force that holds us back, the stronger the force gets. Unless we accept ourselves and our habits and our lives as they are now, we will never overcome the negative forces. When it first dawns on you what has been happening, you may be angry at yourself, the house, or the thoughts that got you in this fix. Don't fight the anger. It is part of the picture, too, and must be accepted. It may be what spurs you to move forward. When it has done its work, you can get back to self-acceptance. I cannot overemphasize the importance of self-acceptance. We are people of dignity. We love order and beauty. We are worthwhile. Zig Ziglar tells of a painting by Rembrandt that sold for over $1 million. Ziglar wondered why the price was so high. Is paint that expensive? Does canvas cost a lot? Of course not. The value of the painting was twofold. Number one, it was painted by a master. And number two, it is one of a kind. This reminds us of our own value. We were painted, shadows and highlights, by a master painter who does all things well, who made both the albatross and the Goonie bird parts of us. We are wonderful because we come from his hand. Like Rembrandt's painting, we too are unique. No one else has our exact makeup, our strengths and weaknesses, shadows and highlights. Rembrandt's paintings contain a lot of shadow, but it enhances their beauty. People's lives have dark places as well as bright ones, difficulties as well as abilities. It is fine to have both.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.